This episode of Artist Decoded is brought to you by No Wave Academy. We are honored to be able to do the work we love by introducing our community to our favorite artists and instructors. And during such unprecedented times, your continued support has meant everything to us. As a thank you, we have decided to offer you a bunch of amazing online courses all at once. The incredible new workshop from one of No Wave's most popular instructors, Nick Runge, paired with the incredible art supplies made by Royal Talons, are all at a discounted rate just for you. Go to nowaveacademy.com, type in summer-20 for 20% off of all online workshops, now until Sunday, July 18th. That's nohwaveacademy.com. Now, on to the episode. Hey everyone, this is your host Yoshino. You're listening to another exciting episode of Artist Decoded. My guest today is my friend, painter Emilio Villalba. And last summer during the quarantine, we tried to do a video interview. We set it up where he was painting me during the interview, but in the end, we decided to can it and redo that interview. And this is the aftermath of that. So what better timing to do it than the release of his upcoming solo show, which is less than a week away. It's at Hashimoto Contemporary, which is in New York, and his show is entitled People and Things, that will be on view between Saturday, July 17th through Saturday, August 7th. So be sure to check it out. I won't be there physically, but if I die over the course of the next few days, maybe I can be there in spirit. Anyways, this is a really great interview where we talk about his latest body of work. Pun intended, no, maybe. We also talked about certain realizations that he's come to over the course of the past few years. We talked about the identity of an artist and leaning into one's truest self. And I think you'll all be able to get a little something out of this interview, so I hope you all enjoy it. If you can, please go to our iTunes page, leave us a review. We also have additional content on YouTube that we just started that page a couple of months ago. So go over there, smash that like button and subscribe, or whatever people say. And also, if you'd like to donate to us, you can go to our Patreon. So here it is, my conversation with my friend, painter Emilio Villalba. Hope you enjoy it. Thanks for taking the time. Thanks for doing this, man. I'm glad that we can do this, and you know, you're not distracted by painting at the same time.
Yeah, that was a difficult task last time for sure.
yeah. But I was wondering too if it was just if it actually might have helped the stream of consciousness or not, or if it just like elongated the entire interview.
Yeah, I mean, maybe a little bit of both. You know, I think it was a good experiment. Definitely in retrospect, I'm like, damn it, I should have just talked to you. You know what I mean? Like that, we would have gotten into it anyway. But there was definitely moments where you would ask a question and there was a delay, right? I'd be like, wait, what was the question? Because I was so focused on trying to get.
Totally.
And also, it's not painting from life. You know, it's painting via Zoom. So it was a little, yeah, it was hard.
And plus, like, there's the microphone in the way and everything. So it's kind of.
For sure.
It's probably difficult. Then you have to. Essentially fill in the blanks, because if the microphone's like covering my face or something like that.
Totally.
But anyways, man, yeah, so how's everything been for your solo show?
Good. I'm dropping off the works tomorrow actually, and they're gonna get photographed, and then I believe towards the end of the week they're gonna get shipped from the warehouse to New York. And I have about I want to say I have 30 paintings at the moment completed, but I believe the show will probably just have maybe somewhere in like 20 to 25 pieces. And it'll be the first, not the first time, but like I'm being a little more aware of like maybe editing it down a bit. So it's not just like, here's everything I've made, you know, in a show. which I've done in the past. Usually I like really want, I don't know, I kind of always have that idea of like, just put everything in. It's all part of the, you know, it's stronger in numbers, kind of an idea, right? And lately I've been really into allowing some breathing room with a particular piece, as opposed to just like jam packing everything in a show.
That makes sense.
I mean, easier said than done, for sure. I mean, look at my backdrop right now. I have like everything just like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And the paintings themselves are getting a little condensed and packed in, but yeah, I don't know. I'm curious to see what the show is going to look like. And I feel like this is the first body of work I've made in a while that isn't 100% like every piece is like super cohesive, you know?
Mm. It seems like just from viewing some of the pieces, especially, you know, viewing in the background, it seems like there's a lot of nostalgia in there.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like it also seems that you're revisiting, you know, that like that time that the painting that I can think of like from the past that kind of comes to mind is at your friend Matt's house. He has that painting of the Tecate can of yours on the wall from like the early, I think it was like early 2000s or something like that. Is that correct?
Was it? Oh, right. Are you talking about the still life?
Yeah, that still life.
It was a still life painting with a couple of books.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So I guess what I'm trying to get at is that it seems like you're revisiting a lot of maybe those earlier ideas with like some of the newer bodies of work that you have. And it seems that over the course of time that, I mean, even with your last show, things are starting to become more personal. It's like you're documenting people around you, but then also like objects from the past and those sort of things. I mean, that's just what it looks like from an observational standpoint, but I don't know. You tell me.
Yeah, no, you're on the money. I think, just to take it back a bit, I kind of entered, it sounds super weird saying it like this, but you know, when I started my first solo show back in 2016, you know, my paintings were portraiture, right? And it was like double eye paintings, black backgrounds and whatever. Right. Yeah. But before I actually even wanted, when I was still an animator back in the early 2000s, I never did oil paintings before. So I used to just do a bunch of watercolors and drawings. Yeah. Those pieces actually look like something like this. Mm. So I feel like it's almost more natural for me to make this more kind of, I want to call it like folk art, but looking at folk art, you know, they kind of just put stuff everywhere and they have these like mini narratives in it from their, you know, day to day or from the past or anything that's kind of like stressing them out or something that they're into or whatever, right? They're like these mini streams of consciousness in a way. So even with the show that I did after all the, you know, the dark background paintings, and then I experimented with just some eye paintings. And then I did a show in 2018. I was painting them in 2017. It was a Symbols of Death, Signs of Life show. And that was the first show that I kind of went back to more of like these little collage-y elements and symbols and making a narrative out of these little icons and reusing them and repurposing them in every painting. So like a skull in one painting could feel romantic, and a skull in another painting could feel like death or whatever, you know?
Yeah.
And I was always into that idea of like reusing a lot of these elements to create a new narrative. Cause that's, for me, that's kind of what happens on a day to day, you know?
I mean, just from viewing your paintings over time, it seems like you're trying to tap more into like that subconscious state of mind, or it's something that's more of more instinctually based. And like, I'm curious what you think about this, because I think a lot of people know you for your eye paintings, but and because of like the advent of social media and how aware everyone is about like what people like and that sort of a thing, was that something that you recognized, that people really knew you for your eye paintings, and then you kind of like broke out of that and did something that was more like instinctual to you?
Are you saying like, was that something a conscious decision of when from during the departure from that work?
Yeah, I guess what I'm trying to say is like, was it a conscious decision to
move forward or progress? I mean, it's a big shift. It was a big shift. So like, yeah. During that time, I think I was just exploring. You know, I still feel like that at that time I was almost still like in quote unquote like art school in a way. Like I was still experimenting the same way someone in art school would experiment. Oh, I'm going to try blue paintings for a year or whatever.
Yeah. And that was like in 2016. Was that in 2016?
Yeah, I think the first like double eye painting or whatever I created was 2014 November. And then 2016 was my solo show. So all of, you know, the last 2 months of 2014 and all of 2015, I spent painting those. And then in 2016, yeah. I had I had two solo shows that year. And then 2017, December or January 2017 was my last like dark background solo show. Mm. And then after that, they moved on, you know, but like with social media and stuff, you know, it might feel a little longer or whatever the presence of that
timelines. Yeah. So I'm curious about like, you know, kind of the ideas, if we can make a summarization of some of the ideas for each solo show. I mean, what are some of the things that you were focusing on for each and how have you seen yourself progress over time?
Oh man. I mean, it's like every single show there's ups and downs and there's things I'm focusing on. There's technical things I'm focusing on and then there's narrative things I'm focusing on as well. But I would say earlier with the darker paintings, I don't know if there was much of a literal narrative, right? How they're just portraits, right? And there were more of an exploration of design and more of a mood, I guess, for lack of a better word. But, you know, it's kind of hard to tap into exactly what I was thinking at that time in retrospect. But looking at the paintings, you know, there were so many of them that I hated. And now looking back, there's a lot of them that I love now. And I see them around, you know, when I go to a collector's house or whatever, and I have there's a painting there from, you know, from that time. I think about how neat they were in a way, you know, like I look at the paintings, I'm like, there's no way I could paint that right now. Like I've tried because people have asked for like commissions and stuff. Well, I can't do that style anymore at all. Like even if I tried, you know, it's so meticulous. And so I don't know, it's just a different time, completely different time. And I feel like I've evolved from that, into what I think paintings should for me look like, you know, not saying that there's nothing wrong with those paintings, but, yeah, there's been a lot of learning, I guess, and progress made from that, you know, for better, for worse, I guess, and, you know, people might think that those paintings are better still, but for me personally to be happier and to be able to explore the way that I want to explore, I think the evolution has been, for me, it's been right, you know.
Definitely. Yeah.
It's always forks in the road.
Yeah. No, yeah, definitely. Yeah. I think it's interesting just how, you know, we change over time and we like ideologically, you know, with our ideas, we will change over time. And then it's interesting when, you know, for someone like yourself that, you know, gets commissions for paintings and those sort of things, how maybe someone might want you to replicate something of the past, but you've moved on from that person that you were back then, who was more maybe mesmerized by technical details, you know, because I mean your paintings now look much looser but in a way that's more fluid as well, and it doesn't seem like you're hung up on like technical abilities. It seems more of, I guess, a stream of consciousness.
Yeah, I mean, I think with the newer works, I mean there's been so many things that have led up to this, right? If I didn't paint those dark backgrounds, I probably would have, I mean, maybe I would have ended up here one way or another, but, you know, there's still a little air of, it's not like those paintings weren't me at all. Right. I mean, I painted them. They're 100% my paintings, but they were influenced by other painters at the time. And looking back, that wasn't necessarily my paintings 100%, you know what I'm saying? Where I feel like now I'm entering, I'm like, who am I, right? As like a, almost like as the last couple of years have been like an identity crisis, right? It's like, okay, I'm still kind of just like chipping away at what I think my signature is through a painting, you know?
Yeah.
And not saying I've arrived. And I think that's the fun part. You know, it's like, it's, you know, 2 years from now, I'm going to look back and be like, okay, I was almost there. You know, like it's always going to feel that way with me. I think it's just this constant evolution and journey. And I love that part of the process. And it's, you know, it's stressful. It's fun. It's challenging. It's rewarding. It's everything. You know, it's, I love that part of the challenge, right? Of the investigation. But yeah, with these, the new paintings and I guess leading up to this stuff, it's one of the earlier ideas I had with this. And I've been actually thinking about it for a long time, and it just started, you know, usually the ideas happen a lot earlier than the actual paintings come into like fruition or whatever the word is. Right.
Definitely.
And just with anything, right. You can have the idea of a photograph the day before, and then like a week later, you end up taking it, or a year later, or whatever, you know, but that idea keeps lingering. I've had this conversation with many friends. It's, you know, it's up and down. Sometimes I stress about what I'm painting, and then other times I just paint, right? And I really wanted a big part of this next step to be, it's not about what I paint, it's how I paint. And I think I might have even brought that up with you before, but that idea, you know, let's say Picasso, for instance, like he could paint anything and it's still a Picasso, you know? Yeah. Totally. There's definitely multiple stages, but there was a good 40 years where like, you know, the paintings relatively looked like, or longer, I mean, but like after a certain time, after all the earlier, you know, like the Cubist, the Red, the Blue period, and even some of his more realism stuff. After that, you know, he could do an apple, he can paint an apple or a portrait or whatever. And it's still like, it's a Picasso, right? Because again, it's not what he paints, it's how he paints it, right? So I'm trying to enter that in a way where, okay, these are the things that I like about the tactile, like the tactical approach, or the, I don't know if that's the right word, but the surface and the quality of the...
Oh, like the technical approach or the...
Yeah, technical, and then the actual surface, like the application of the paint and
I see.
All that stuff. So I've been a little more aware of that as almost a viewer, you know, like leaving the paintings up. I'm like, okay, what do I like about the surface of this painting versus this one over here or whatever? And
yeah,
so I'm, you know, I'm constantly trying to do a little bit or more now I'm trying to do a little more editing and be a little more self-aware of my own work, which is so hard, you know. It's like just anyone's personality, you know, you mean it could be, it's always hard to look at yourself from the outside in, you know?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. And then it's interesting when people have their own observations of your work and then they can tell you certain things that, I mean, it could be a projection of their ideas or it could be spot on. And then it, you know, maybe something that they say strikes something in you and you're like, oh wow, I didn't really think of it like that, but yeah, that is what I was going through at that time or something to that, you know? It's also interesting, like what you were saying about sitting on an idea for a very long time and then painting it. Cause I've definitely done that with photography, having an idea sitting on it for a long time. And then, I don't know, like, I want to know your experience too, but I think like being able to lessen that time as you know more technical things, you know exactly like how you want things to be portrayed, like on a canvas or in my, you know, medium of a photograph, you know, that sort of time between the idea and the execution can get shorter.
Oh, right.
Depending on how, I mean, you know, like it's great to have an idea, right? But it's also about turning that idea into action too. And then, so there's all these psychological things that we go through as well when, you know, we don't trust ourselves to actually execute the idea, you know, but really the execution of the idea leads us to the next thing, right? And then that accumulates over time and then you have more ideas, right?
For sure. I mean, it's like, you know, painting and creativity like that, or any sort of creative outlet is it's a, you know, it's not only a concept or an idea, but it's also like the act of doing it, right? So it's like a muscle too. So you can have an idea, not act on it, but as soon as you act on it and start creating, it's you're in it. You know what I mean? So like that window that you were talking about does shorten because it's like that muscle. You're already warmed up. You're ready to work. So that as soon as the next idea comes out, you already have your camera ready. You already have your paint ready. Like you're ready to go, you know, and exactly. you get that momentum flowing for sure. It's funny. I was just listening to, I probably won't even get the words right, but I was watching this little YouTube video of a neuroscientist or a neurologist who used to be a skater, and he was like tied in with a lot of pro skaters, and they asked him about the creativity process and like the endorphins and all that stuff. And there was one little comment he said, or a little idea that he had from a study that showed like, if you're at a bar with your friends or whatever, like, oh, tomorrow I'm gonna wake up and write a book, right? I think that was the example he was talking about. And everyone at the bar is like, dude, you should totally write a book. And the guy's like, fuck yeah, I'm going to write a book. And like, he wakes up the next morning and he never writes the book because he already, all the reward system and like the endorphins from actually writing the book and creating the book was already used up at the bar by everyone, like already praising him about it before wise. You know what I mean? Yeah. So I think that's why he was talking about the reward system versus the actual act of doing something. And like with social media nowadays and, you know, people are sometimes, not everyone, but you know, there's a lot of that, yeah. of the idea of like, maybe it wasn't meant to be, or maybe you're doing it for the wrong reasons or whatever. Right. So you got to find that thing or that object or the concept or whatever that motivates you to actually get to work. Right.
Yeah. Definitely.
And I that just kind of stuck with me. And I never thought about it that way of like, because I've done that too. I always kid myself. I'm like, man, tomorrow I'm going to wake up and instead of painting, I'm going to do a sculpture. And I'm like, dude, I'm not going to, you know what I mean? I'm not a 3D yeah. artist. Like maybe yeah. one day, but
totally.
Then again, that idea, I'm like, yeah, I could see my show with like, you know, a bunch of Tecate cans like stacked up or whatever. But I'm like,
yeah,
dude, there's going to be Tecate cans stacked up in the corner anyway, right?
you could just photograph it. You photograph the remnants of your show, or you just photograph totally. Tecate cans from around the city or something like that.
For sure. Or just put a sign in the middle of the galleries, just drop them here or whatever.
Yeah, but, yeah, exactly. And then, yeah, you can have your postmodernist little art piece.
For sure.
With people interacting with it. But no, I think that's interesting. Actually, first of all, I want to know, like, do you know who the professional skateboarder was?
If you look it up, it's Carl Watson's friend, who's a Bay Area, like, legend skateboarder. Okay. So Carl Watson with a K, K-A-R-L, Watson. And if you look up Carl Watson, like, neurologist interview or whatever, it'll pop up on YouTube. I forget the dude's name. And I'm not sure he was a pro, but he hung around that crowd in the 90s, I think, like the Embarcadero days or whatever. I think
the
not
skateboarding crowd.
Yeah. I'm not too sure about the dude's history or whatever, but yeah, it was a cool little, I think it was like 18 minutes long. So it's a pretty in-depth little Zoom meeting between the two of them.
Cool. I guess what I was going to ask though is, you know, you're speaking about the reward system and trying to be aware of like where we get our rewards and, you know, what that means to like the psychology of the way that we think. Right. And, have you read Atomic Habits?
Mm-mm. No,
it's by this author. I believe it's by James Clear. And okay. I recently, listened to it and I'm re-listening to the audiobook, but part of that audiobook, it's talking about how we identify ourselves. And if you identify, so for instance, like I just got into running this past year and now I'm starting to identify myself as a runner, you know, and what does a runner do? A runner runs, right? So by telling people that I'm a runner, I'm slowly embedding it into my psychology so that I create that habit for myself. So if you started saying that, oh, I'm a sculptor, slowly over time, you would have to show that, right?
Right.
And then he also gives an example of when people say that, like someone that had the habit of smoking before, and if you say, I'm not a smoker, then that over time will fulfill itself, as opposed to say, oh, I don't want a cigarette.
Right.
When you identify as a smoker. So I just think about those things too, because there's all these little brain tricks that you can do to embed. I mean, really, it's like you're saying, it's a muscle.
Yeah.
You know, painting is a decision that you do, and maybe it's also a compulsion in some ways because you feel the need to paint and to express yourself in the painting, but it's also a muscle and a habit, you know. And I think if we break these things down into and understand that, oh, this is a habit, this is something I really want to do, then you just show up and you do it, right? So it doesn't have to be like all like I don't know, fluffy and romantic, like, oh, I only like paint when I, you know, have inspiration.
Right.
And I think that's kind of like a false narrative that a lot of people play into their heads.
Totally. I mean, for me, I've just stepping into that a bit too, I think maybe one of my biggest issues has always been not owning up to that identity. I've always felt like a little bit of an identity crisis. Like, I've never really thought of myself as a painter still, you know. So it's, sometimes it's hard for me to tell people I'm a painter. Like,
why is that?
I don't know. I have no idea. Like, I used to tell people I was just a teacher, you know. Like, I didn't want to be like, maybe I didn't want to get into it or whatever immediately off the bat in a conversation or something. But yeah, when someone would be like, oh, what do you do? Oh, I'm a teacher. And then it would, like, you know, it's like, oh, cool, that's great, blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, later down the road, it would come up that, oh, what do you teach? It's like, oh, college. Oh, what do you, it's like drawing, you know. And then I wouldn't even start with painting. I would say drawing, you know. I don't know. It's super weird. But
do you think it's also because you live in San Francisco as well, and it's like such a heavily, the community over there is heavily involved with tech. So do you think that if you said, oh, I'm a painter, then like that would mean something?
Yeah, I don't know. I think overall, okay, back in LA, this is like 2006 or something. And this is when, going back to the idea of like the identity of like, if I tell people this is what I am, I'll eventually do it, right? So I think this was like 2006. 2006 in LA as an animator, we were at, this is going to date me, but we were at a Ratatat show. Do you know that? Remember that band?
I love Ratatat. I mean, I loved them back in the day. Yeah. This will date both of us. It's okay.
And we were at the show, and some of new friends that we had just met at like some animation thing or whatever, I had told them at the dinner that I was a painter, right? Like, yeah, an animator, but like that I was into painting. I hadn't decided to quit animation yet or anything like that. That I was really into, like, I want to be a painter. You know, that was like my goal, kind of. And I wasn't even thinking I was going to quit as an animator. I was just going to be like a Sunday painter or whatever. And we saw them at the Ratatat show, like, I don't know, like a week later. So it was super fresh. And the person introduced me to her friend as, oh, this is Emilio. He's a painter. And I remember just like the feeling of like a fraud. You know what I mean? I'm like, I'm not a painter, but I had to own it. That I'm like, no, I'm not. I didn't say like I'm not a painter or anything like that. But yeah, that for some reason that like has stuck with me. So maybe after that, I've always been really aware of how I introduce myself.
Yeah.
And it kind of stuck because I didn't want to. You know, I hate feeling that being a fraud or whatever. And I've been caught in so many little mini lies like that since when I was younger. That I think when now. I'm really like, I want people to know exactly what's happening. It's like, no, I'm not this or that, you know?
Interesting. Yeah.
To take it back to, I got caught at a video, at a Hollywood video by a friend. We were talking about the Basquiat art show retrospect that happened at the, I forget where it was. It must've been at the LACMA. So this is maybe like 2003 or yeah, it must have been 2003. Man, maybe it was 2005. Anyway, whatever. Doesn't matter. But somewhere in that little era or that time, there was a Basquiat like retrospect at LACMA, I believe, in LA. And I saw this kid. He went to my high school. And I went back home to visit my mom or whatever, and I was at the video store, Hollywood Video, and he knew that I was going to like animation school, right? And our high school, there weren't that many people that went into like arts or whatever. You know, it was like a very more kind of conservative school or whatever, or area, Orange County. And this kid was cool. Like he had like dyed hair and like, you know, he was like had the cool car or what. He was just fresh, right?
Yeah.
And he was part of the cool crew. I was never like cool kid at all. So just the fact that people would talk to me after high school, I was always like tripping on, right? And we had talked about Basquiat a few times before that. And I used to run into him in that neighborhood all the time. You know, at that shopping center, there was like a grocery store and whatever. And he was like, oh man, did you catch the Basquiat show at the LACMA? I'm like, oh yeah, I was just there. And he was like, and I did not go, you know, but I like, it was one of those things where like, I wanted to like, I was so into Basquiat, like that was my, like my painter was Basquiat, you know?
Yeah.
And, he was like, oh, when'd you go? And I was like, oh, I just went last weekend. It's like, oh, that's funny because it ended a month ago. And I was like, oh, all right, I gotta go. And like, he was so like, I remember him, like saying, like, he looked at me and he was like, oh, that's funny. It ended a month ago. And I was like, I froze up. And then he even said something like, what do you gotta lie like that? And, I was like, oh, I don't know, man. I'm like, I didn't, like, you know what I mean? I was just like literally caught in a lie.
Wow.
And I just wanted to be, I just wanted to be cool, you know, like whatever. Yeah, so after that moment, I was like, damn it, now I have to go to every art show in the world, you know.
Like, you just felt like enormous amount of shame at that point.
Dude, it was so bad. I'm like nervous about it now. That was the first time I might have told Michelle that story before, but yeah, there was that time like was, yeah, that little things like that always like bit me in the butt, you know.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that's a pretty relatable concept of, just, you know, as a kid, you're trying to fit in, or when you're, you know, younger version of yourself.
I'm a late bloomer. still doing that stuff at 30, you know?
Well, I mean, that's part of like the conscious decision making too. It's, I mean, there's no way that in a conversation like that I would know everything that you know, right?
Right.
And then it's interesting, yeah. I think, as a social criticism or as a social thing, right, to think of having conversations with people and then they're like, and you think that they know the thing that referencing, but they actually don't. But it's just like most of the time, I would say probably like 99.9% of the time, people don't get caught in a lie, because generally maybe it's a social courtesy that people won't call the other person out, right?
Right. Well, I think also too, like we learn, going back to like how we're training each other to be in an interview or in a conversation, or even separate the two. It's like, is this a conversation or is it an interview or both, right? So when you're asked, you know, for instance, if like I said, just top of my head right now, I'd be like, oh, like the artist, I just read that the artist, John Hassell or whatever passed away. And like, oh yeah. And then like that person might not have any idea who that person is, but they said, oh, like, cause you just learn to like, if you just say, oh, or wow, that's crazy. Like it just speeds the, you know, you just kind of move along.
Yeah.
And then you always get, like, oh, do you know who that is? No. You know what I mean? And it becomes like, whatever. Well, but yeah, that happens all the time.
But that's also the communication exchange too, because, you know, I could either pause and be like, oh, you know, tell me more about that. Or I can pause and be like, you know, and essentially what I'm saying is, if I don't know who that artist is, or, you know, that whatever happened to that artist, you know, I'm just acknowledging that you said something. Right. But in your mind, you might think, oh, this guy knows what I'm talking about. Right. But I think it's just a social thing where a lot of us want to get along and understand the other person and just have like kind of like a nice conversation. Or maybe we might want to project to that person that, oh, we're intelligent as well. Right. So I just think it's a really interesting thing in terms of how like social communication structures are, you know, like what our intention is for either agreeing or trying to move on with the conversation or lying in a conversation. It's just, right. It's fascinating.
Dude, absolutely.
Yeah.
And it's funny how like demoralizing or embarrassing it can be in retrospect. You know what I mean? Like reliving those moments in your head sometimes, like, man, like as if it were like right now, obviously we're being recorded, but those moments are being recorded in our brains, are being recorded in their minds, whoever you're having the conversation with.
Yeah.
And it, like, you know, I'm still thinking back to that Hollywood video incident and I'm like, God damn it. Like, why, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, it has a lot to do with fitting in. I mean, the same dude, I remember we were talking about the Beatles back in the day, or at another day at Hollywood Video. Yeah. And he would say something like, I would say something like, oh, I love that song, I'm so tired, but you know, the John Lennon song. And then he would say, oh, I hate that song. And then I'd say, oh yeah, I guess, yeah, it's not that great. You know what I mean? Agreeing with them after the fact.
Well, and that makes sense because the way that you portrayed this person, you know, he was like the quote unquote cool kid and someone that you would want to fit in with. Right. So, but it's also an interesting thing where we don't, because we want to fit in, we don't stand by our decisions of liking something, like in that situation when you like that song. And
totally.
We almost deny ourselves that right to be able to express ourselves. And I think that's kind of a microcosm of how, you know, a lot of times people don't listen to their instincts. And then over the course of time, that builds and compounds and builds, you know, to where it's,
for
you're
sure.
constantly not listening to your instinct. And, you know, and that can show up if you're a painter or someone who creates art, right? That can show up in your artwork, whether you're aware of it or not.
Yeah, I think the last couple of years, for sure, that's what I've been trying to own, you know, and Michelle, my partner, has been really good at giving me confidence with that. My upbringing, for sure, that's what it's sort of like tainted in a way. Like, I've been so insecure my entire life as a kid. And I think in, you know, especially meeting Michelle, she's definitely given me confidence into just, you know, being myself in everything I do, you know, and what I listen to, what I'm wearing, to the furniture we buy, to my paintings, whatever it is, you know, just like fully just own it. And doesn't mean I'm going to be perfect in terms of like not being insecure or anything like that. But it has to do with that for sure. Like growing up very on the other side of that, you know, of like not cool or whatever. And who knows? I mean, I don't even know. Maybe it was a generation thing or a culture thing or the movies that we watched or the shows that we watched of like the pressure of being cool, you know, when did that become the priority, you know? And then in some cultures, it's like being intelligent is what's cool. Right. And then it's like, dang, you have to do both now.
Yeah. I mean, I don't have the facts on me, but I think because of the advent of social media that exponentially the insecurities and, you know, being aware of however many other people there are on this planet that are plugged into social media. And, you know, I think, I mean, even going back to that Atomic Habits book, you know, part of that book is talking about segmenting, like having a device for a specific thing. So they give an example of like, you know, on your iPad or whatever, your tablet, you have your social media and then that's tucked away. And then you take your social media off of your phone. And so that you have to make a conscious decision instead of like an automatic response, right? To check social media, you know, and you have it like at a specific place. And it's just like, I don't know. I think it's just interesting how there's like these various like sort of ways to trick your brain in order to,
yeah, it's like techniques, methods.
Yeah. To stay like mentally, I don't know, mentally healthy in this day of,
it's also like, you're just being aware of when to check into that stuff. It's like, you know, exactly. Back in the day, let's say high school, it's like, okay, the bell rings for lunch, time to like walk the halls or whatever. And you're ready for these moments. It's like, all right, you step into the classroom. Okay, time to learn, right? So you have these moments. Whereas, like, you know, social media, every time you chime in, you're it's like your social hour again. You know, you're at lunch, just trying to catch up on what everyone is doing, who's posting what drama's happening, like who's looking good, like, you know what I mean? Yeah, you have everything at that moment, and it's just like, foof, 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 you know?
Yeah,
it's pretty wild. But yeah, I think, you know, when I entered Instagram, luckily I'm not, I mean, I can't even imagine having an Instagram in high school, you know, like so lucky. We're lucky that we got Instagram. Like, you know, I didn't make an account until I was 27 or 28 or something like that, you know, or maybe a little younger. But, and then even then I wasn't posting art, you know, I wasn't even painting then. I was just like doing other stuff and just posting photos of my friends and whatever, you know. But yeah, I think what I was trying to say is luckily at the age, I guess, that I had social media, and maybe just me, it helped me just be myself. Like, I was just like, I'm just going to post whatever I want. And it worked out, you know, in a way. And then to the paintings too, where I never was like insecure in a way. With painting, it's one of those things, like, I feel insecure in retrospect, but while I'm painting them, I always think, I'm like, man, this is the best painting I've ever made, you know? And I keep just like doing that. So with painting has always been, and drawing has always been that outlet. Creative outlets have always been my source of confidence. And even in confident outlet or whatever, I don't know what the right term is, but for instance, going back to my high school days or middle school or whatever, yes, I was a geek, but when I did a drawing or something, for some reason, you know, even the cool kids were like, oh man, you know how to draw, whatever. And then they would go back to making fun of me for something else. You know, it was like that. The drawing part was always like very sacred in a way.
It was almost like your social currency.
Totally. For sure. Yeah. That was, if there was a team infinity at that time, we're like, all right, we need 10 people that can do this, this and that. And be like, I could probably be the artist, you know, in that, at that time. Small circle. I wasn't a good, but you know what I mean? I was definitely into it for sure. Like, I got busted in middle school a lot from teachers for drawing in my notebook, you know, as opposed to listening in class. I have no idea how I passed middle school or high school.
Yeah.
But, well, I copied a lot.
Well, you know, I'm sure we all have our fair share of that. But so I, you know, I guess in hindsight, you know, looking back at these pieces that you've created for this upcoming show, what are some of your thoughts on them?
I mean, right now I love them, you know. I mean, I like being in the room with them. I'm sad to have to see some of them go. I wish I had more time to work on this new sort of body of work that's like right behind me. These ones that are a little more collagey. And I had a great time making them, for sure. And, you know, it's an investigative journey along the way. They're not just designs, right? So while I'm making, you know, I've been working on these for a little while now. And yeah, I'm always learning new things. Every piece is a little progress from the last one. There's always like five or six pieces that are like, okay, I'm going to try this over and over and over and then move on a little bit, you know? But on a more literal sense or conceptual base, the pieces started out as the more collage pieces, not the portraits, but the collage pieces started out from an experiment. I had read one of Konevsky's teaching methods, thinking about his concept of the way that he paints, right? Like, without even talking about what was in the writing or whatever. But if you look at his paintings, it looks like he paints and flips it upside down, paints again, flips it upside down, and then paints again, right? And then sometimes he has like these upside down figures recurring or popping through, colors from a portrait underneath. And, you know, there's definitely a story underneath the main painting, right? And all of that adds to the piece. So I just thought, how would that look if I did like a more of a literal, I was really into Alice Neel at the time when I started the series. So on a more illustrative version. So I was like, how would it look if I did an illustrative version of that? Mm-hmm. And that's sort of what happened with the still life of like painting objects on top of objects. So the other concept I had, okay, I'm going to do that, but I'm only going to pick objects that found on the floor. So I picked a bicycle wheel, a shopping cart, a shoe, and my foot. And then I thought, what do all four things have in common? And I just thought, wiry. I'm like, I could make my foot wiry. I can make the shoe look wiry. The wheels has wire. The cart is made out of wires, right? Kind of shopping cart. And yeah, and I just painted them right on top of each other. And it was super simple, you know, just like that. And so I just kind of gave myself like a little assignment. And it evolved from that. I made another piece with objects found on the floor, and that's where the cars came in. Socks. I had my glasses, a coat, or a, you know, shirt hanger on the floor, and so it turned into this little almost scavenger hunt in my apartment, and you know, still during quarantine. And with the cars, what was really cool about it is, I'm sure you guys experienced this too in LA, but in SF, you know, there wasn't any street sweeping. And early on into shelter in place, there was no one was really driving. So the you see the same car just parked over and over because no one would move their cars anymore, you know? And in the Mission, we had these, I never look at cars. Like I look at cars and like, well, that's a pretty car or whatever, but not into cars. Like I have no idea what the names of these cars are and whatever. But so that's how I started getting involved with like painting cars and that were in our neighborhood, just parked. And now I'm like super into cars. You know, it's only been a year, and every time I see a car, I have to stop and take a photo of the old cars, you know? Yeah. And then, so the paintings just sort of evolved. And at first they were little mood pieces and trying to create little storylines based off what we had in the apartment. So like, for instance, I have this brown painting up here. So this is our mailbox, like not our mailbox, but our the little like wire basket next to our mailbox with mail that you just, that's like throwaway mail, you know, junk mail or whatever. Mm-hmm. And that the apartment, like, you know, the mailman or whoever, the magic person just comes and gets rid of it, you know? And then the coat hangers, the glasses, my shoe, the Converse. And then the sink actually is the sink from the bar around the corner on our block. So it's all like sort of, it, you know, it's this little scavenger hunt of things that I have or that I'm seeing around their neighborhood. And the narrative for this one was, I was thinking of like the movie Rocky or The Exorcist. And I was thinking of a scenario of like a priest that lived alone in a New York apartment. Like, you know, it's what kind of mood can I create with these little pieces to create that? So, you know, the colors are very like priest-like, right? And then there's a little cross right there from the sink.
Oh, interesting.
You know, so it creates a cross right there. So the little religious undertone, and then the shoe just going, you know, following it straight down.
Did you think about that in hindsight, the cross, or were you thinking about that when you were painting it?
Yeah, while I was painting it, I always thought when I took a photo of the sink, I remember looking back, I'm like, oh, that looks like a cross. I wonder how I could use that, you know? And I created another. So a few of these pieces have a religious undertone. It's not the main drive. But I was just, they became kind of shrines or altars. And, you know, being raised Catholic or from my parents that were like super Catholic, you know, growing up in Mexico, my dad grew up going to, you know, I think all elementary school, middle school and high school were Catholic schools for him.
Yeah.
And my mom was, her family was super religious. Now, I'm not religious at all, but I grew up in that culture, you know, of like, my brother and I would beg our mom not to take us to church on Sundays, you know, that kind of a thing. Yeah. So I have a bunch of these pieces that kind of have that feeling. I mean, I even put a Jesus head in that one right there. You can see it right where my hand is right there.
Oh,
it's like this sculpture. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And then I'll show one more here. So this one, a little a self-portrait that was inspired by Gauguin, self-portrait with a Jesus in the back. So if there's three, the colors, again, going back to that idea of the priest or whatever. So I painted this one and that brown one and this, the candle one right around the same time, like back to back to back. Mm-hmm. And, so there's three little religious things in here. The easel is meant to look like a cross. Mm. And then I have the wedding tattoo on my hand. And then on the shirt, there's a little cross there too. And that's just on the shirt. So it's not like I added it or anything like that.
Yeah. I like those little nuggets.
Yeah. So I just thought they were cool. Not necessarily meant to be so literal, but when you hear the story, it kind of like, oh yeah, I can, you know, you can kind of persuade it in that direction.
Mm. It's interesting how you construct some of these ideas, and I'm sure as you, well, actually I'm curious. So for a lot of these pieces, do you come up with the idea and then paint it, or do you paint like little sections, you know, for the sort of like collage based ideas, and then it just kind of is what it is at the end? Or what sort of process is it?
It's a little bit of both for sure. It's impossible to control every part of the narrative, especially with someone else involved looking at it as a viewer. You know, you're never going to be able to control that sense. And that's never been the goal. It's one of those things that seems to me even impossible sometimes to push the narrative that way. But just like in a painting, you know, you can start with the drawing. Someone that's never painted before, you can think of the drawing and you're like, wow, if my drawing isn't perfect in the beginning, the painting is going to be off. But it's not true. You can start the drawing some one way and then slowly manipulate the drawing as you're painting. You know what I mean? So you can do the same with a narrative. You can start a painting and then slowly start to push the design and push the narrative in another direction, either by changing colors, by moving pieces around, by adding new pieces. You know what I mean? There's more ways that you can change the narrative. So that's why I say it's both, right? I'll start with an idea and a concept and then paint things out or add things or change colors as I'm going, because they take so long, right? Like this piece took maybe a couple weeks, the one right behind me. Wow. And, you know, candles went from red to orange, faces went from green to red, cars changed colors, things got painted out and added as I was going. And it's a diptych too. So the top piece was actually supposed to be underneath. Yeah. So little things like that, you know, and it's not just the narrative in terms of for it to be literal, you know, colors trigger things, imagery, triggers things in people, and design, right? I mean, you can have a triangle creates a different mood than a circle does, or a grid is a completely different mood than something going in perspective, right? And again, it's not also all forced, but once I kind of have something going, I'm like, oh, I see an M here in shape. I'm going to kind of help that come alive a little bit more.
Yeah.
So with this one, I've had a simple like big V design. Oh, let me get my hands there. Like going that way and that way, right? Mm-hmm. There is like a big kind of V. Yeah. And then where the orange eyes are right behind me, going over to the kiss heads, and then going back over that way. It's like a big M down here. And again, it's not supposed to be a literal line. It's more of an implied thrust. And then the bunch of coincidences that are happening along the main grid there to keep that structure of the, you know, the H or whatever, the big grids. Which I've always had in my work, in terms of not a literal grid, but I like placing things along, you know, kind of collage-y like that.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's kind of the fun of it too, is you have a certain intention for, you said a couple of things there. It's like, and it's an investigation and the layering of things, you know, of objects, you know, for this instance, onto your piece. And, you know, I think about just like the sort of layers to our ideas that can happen. And then the eventual, thing to happen after that is, you know, the representation of a work of art. Right. So I think it's good to, I mean, everyone has their own process, but I think it's good to be open to allowing the piece to tell you what you should paint on it, essentially. Right. And then to allow it for a further investigation, because then I think that that could also allow you to be more fluid, and then also, to
honest.
Want to continue. Yeah. And honest, and to want to continue painting, you know, I think, you know,
exactly.
similar to what you were talking about with the rewards, I think it's good to be able to check our rewards and to understand what our attachment is. Like if we're attaching our ego too much to a singular piece of artwork, or attaching our ego, not even just to art, if you're an artist, but to just anything, you know, and that's like an interesting thing to observe within ourselves. Is the driving force behind that, you know, do we want that reward on social media? Do we want that validation from like our peers, or what is the actual thing that's driving us to create this thing? You know? So I think about that a lot in as a macro psychological perspective idea, you know?
For sure. And I mean, maybe the beauty is that you get it from multiple sources. You know, it's you feel rewarded. You're getting rewarded from your peers. You're getting rewarded from your partners or significant others or whatever. You're getting it from social media. You know what I mean? It like, and then sometimes it's unbalanced. You know, maybe you are getting it from, you're only getting that reward from certain areas or whatever, you know. But yeah, I mean, for me going back, you know, really the driving force is this investigation. And maybe I am investigating my ego or investigating my identity. And, you know, going back to what you said just a second ago, this new direction, I am trying to be more honest and free with just letting the design itself in a way. Right. And letting it grow and being myself in terms of painting everything in one painting. You know, a couple of years ago, and this is how affected I get by things. A couple of years ago, this dude, musician dude, you know, he was in a pretty well-respected band. He was talking about my work at the gallery. And he said that, he's like, man, your paintings are everything. Like everything is in your paintings. It's like, but you know, I took it as a critique, you know, and maybe he was kind of critiquing it in a way. And he said, you know, think about like in a song, you know, in a song, you don't have to put everything in there. It's the love song or the hate song or the sad song or whatever, you know, it's like, it's just keep it one thing. And so after that, you know, my show back home that I had last year was essentially just, here's the tiles of the bathroom. Here's my floor. Here's Michelle in the kitchen or whatever, you know? So it was like very simple ideas, minimal, very minimal. And this show started out very minimal that way as well, because I had just launched from that show. You know, how can I go from painting a bathroom tile to immediately doing that? I had to earn my way back up to painting a million things on a painting, you know, just for myself. That was the evolution to get there, you know? Yeah. So some of the earlier pieces from this show were still very minimal, exploring this new direction of going back into, you know, interpreting things through other objects or creating a storyline through other objects. Like, there is a storyline here, but we're seeing it through a sink, a couple of shoes, and you know what I mean? Like, how do you create a storyline from these almost inanimate objects or objects that aren't really, you know, it's not a portrait, it's not telling you how to feel or whatever. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that I had working my way back up to these paintings. They are very exciting to me and they're very challenging and I want to paint more. You know, I can't wait to start like to keep exploring these new, they're endless. Yeah. So it is really exciting for me where I'm at. And again, not saying that they're done or they're complete or I've arrived or whatever. It's just, you know, I've hit maybe a little plateau and then let's explore it a little more and see where it goes. And for me, the next step in the process is being a little more painterly than illustrative. So allowing, in my way though, obviously I'm not going to end up being like de Kooning or whatever and just going crazy or even Konevsky for that matter, where, you know, Konevsky and de Kooning have a lot more in common than maybe Konevsky and Alice Neel, right? I don't know if that analogy makes sense, but maybe doing this and then doing my version of it and like flipping it upside down and painting another collage right on top and seeing what happens, you know, like just doing that kind of stuff and painting more on top of other objects and getting my version of what painterly is. And, you know, I'm getting little snippets of that, allowing paint to show through in layers and getting that sort of abstract school of art in there. And really, that's just for me. Like, I love seeing that kind of work at galleries. I think it's beautiful. You know, you go to a show, and I just went to a recent show at Dolby Chadwick Gallery here in San Francisco. The paintings were gorgeous. And there were, you know, paintings of Jennifer Paczynski, I believe is her name.
Yeah, Jennifer. Yeah, Jennifer Paczynski.
And, you know, they're huge paintings. And, well, some of them are huge. And there were paintings of people at the park and in the water, you know, kind of these more leisure activities or whatever. Mm-hmm. Gorgeous. You know, they had beautiful color and it looked like that, you know, it's like, okay, there was a landscape underneath or something underneath. She took the painting, flipped it upside down and then painted a new scene on top of that. And just seeing those colors underneath, I'm like, oh, I love that. You know, it's like going to a music show and hearing a guitar solo. And, mm-hmm. you know, the thought of a guitar solo, you're like, oh, okay, well, like, you know, everyone's heard a guitar solo. Like, why? Right. But when you hear it, you're like, damn, that's good. You know?
Yeah.
And that's the stuff that excites me as a viewer. So I'm kind of always a little bit, you know, there's things that excite me as a painter and there's things that excite me as a viewer. And I want a little bit of that, you know, for sure.
Yeah. Hmm. It seems like you're trying to marry all of these ideas or, you know, commingle them all together. You know, it sounds like something that is really attractive to you is flipping the painting upside down and, you know, repainting over it or painting something over and trying to accumulate layers. And I mean, metaphorically, that could speak of just our ideas and the way that we intake the things that other people are doing, or, you know, just creating these layers which compound and create the inevitable piece that you work on, right? But then something that's also interesting that I was thinking about while you were talking is how sensitive we can be to the opinions of people that we respect, right? And that also challenges, I guess it's interesting. If you really respect someone, sometimes you will be swayed by them. They might not even understand how much of an impact that they're making on your life by telling you this thing about your piece, right? And
right.
Yeah. I mean, you know, and we're all human and, you know, it's hard to just like distance ourselves from that when we really respect someone and someone's opinion, you know,
but, for sure.
And I think that's what's interesting too, is because that challenges, you know, if he never said that, for instance, like he might have not challenged you to want to go back to more minimalist in terms of subject matter, like your last show, you know,
yeah,
which might have not, yeah, made you want to transition to a more maximalist sort of thing that you would want to do for this show, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. And it's having the confidence too, and like, or lack of confidence too, in owning who you are. You know, after a while, it's like, well, all right, this is who I am. And not everyone is going to gel, or everyone's going to like everyone's art, or, you know what I mean? It goes in that direction as well.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's the same thing about talking about controlling the narrative, right? Like, you might have an intention for what you want to do with your piece, and other people may look at like specific colors or specific objects within your piece, and they might be able to tie that down to something that's very personal within them, and they might hate your piece because of it or love your piece because of it. Right. But that,
right.
You know, I think it's interesting, just getting people's opinion about different artworks or, different films, for instance, because we all have our varying opinions on things. And, I don't know if anyone's opinion is necessarily right. You know, it's whatever someone's opinion is. And,
for sure.
I don't know. Yeah. And then I think about that, and I think about just how people can be, I don't know, kind of not very open to the ideas of other people. And
I think that's a big issue for sure. Yeah. And I've been thinking about that recently too. I'm like, I love,
yeah.
I mean, this is, now it's going to sound cheesy, but I love everyone's art, you know, like I go, like I always, I'm, and now I'm, I don't feel like I'm trying to, like, you know, show off or boost my ego by saying that, but like, that's, you know, I feel like looking outside in, looking at who I am and what what I say and what I think when I go to museums or galleries and whatever. I'm like, I am really open to all art, you know, like, yeah, of course there are definitely pieces I'm like, you know, take it or leave it, but I'm not fixating on the art that I hate in shows. You know, I just love painting and yeah. I love seeing art on the walls, photography, installation. Like even the last couple of years, I'm looking at stuff on the floor, you know, like I've never used to do that, but I love the experience of seeing what people create and like being and having my mind change or even altered or stimulated or even tripping at a show from something that like is like optically like a trip, you know, it's just, yeah. It's an illusion or whatever.
It also seems like you're becoming a lot more secure in yourself as a person, because if you're secure in mm-hmm. yourself, I mean, you know, theoretically speaking, if you're secure in yourself, then you wouldn't necessarily have to place a negative judgment on someone else's piece. You know, you could just see it for, oh, this person is expressing themselves, and they're expressing themselves in a way that, you know, maybe I wouldn't do, but
right.
it's awesome to know that someone is expressing themselves, you know, and then so you're more open to things that maybe before you might have looked at and you're like, wow, that really sucks, and you would have placed a judgment on it, right?
Absolutely.
I don't know. I think it's good to I don't know. I think the more mature I'm getting, the more it's better to just be open to a lot of people's ideas and be okay with that and not have to like feel slighted by someone else's idea. You know what I mean?
No, for sure. I think, and it's all being of, I was just talking to my friend of like him and I, we get along so well, and I've brought him up every single interview. My friend Jason, we always end up hanging out, and and I've talked about this too, you know, like you go all week with working or whatever, and then you meet up and it's just like an explosion of words and talking and whatever. And it's because we're both very curious about everything. We just want to learn. We want to be able to like, I was like, dude, your brain, like, I mean, this is like our Wayne's World moment or whatever. But I'm like, dude, your brain is like a Ferrari or whatever. You need to get that car like running, you know, you need to get it going. If it's just sitting in the garage the whole time, it's like angry, you know, like yeah. you need to take your car out for a drive. You know, it's like yeah. your brain, you need this brain stimulation of like talking to people and getting the endorphins and of like communicating with someone on yeah. the same level and exploring where the conversation goes
yeah.
intellectually or conceptually or whatever, you know. And we could even just be talking about the color red, you know, that was his example or whatever, but it's true, you know, with certain people, you can just say the color red and you could go for hours, you know, where like someone else, you know, maybe there's, you know, that's where people are compatible or not or whatever. And that's when, you know, there's differences in personalities. And it's just like art too, you know, there's going to be certain paintings and things that talk to people or trigger people or want to, you know, dive in deeper and what, who created it, why they created it and blah, blah, blah. Right. But the other thing I was going to say too, is that recently in the last couple of weeks, I've been really, maybe last couple of years, I'm really more concerned. And again, my ideas are always going to be ahead of what I'm actually producing, right? I'm talking about flipping paintings upside down and stuff, but I still haven't done that. You know, like I'm not there quite yet. I am painting on top of things, but little snippets. I'm like, oh, yeah. I'm just going to paint this. Like,
it sounds like you're workshopping. You're kind of like workshopping the idea out a bit.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. And letting it evolve naturally without forcing it. But sometimes it is good to force it a bit and just really test it out.
Totally.
But I've been really into paintings by people, specifically Jackson Pollock right now, who I've always been a huge fan of, and I've probably brought him up before in previous interviews, but or conversations with you. But I'm really into his like proto drip paintings, you know, like he's known for the drip splash paintings, but I'm really into the paintings right before. And 10 years ago, I'm like, that is the ugliest painting I've ever seen in my life. You know, like, and there's one at the MoMA, and that one's like, over the years, it's just kind of been like, like, it's like every year, it's like, it's getting a little better for me, you know? Mm. And a couple of weeks ago, a month ago, I'm like, that's the most beautiful painting I've ever seen, you know? And because it was like, it's not about, with his paintings, they're not about being beautiful. You know, they are beautiful in their own way because they just exist as an object. And believe me, like, I love the drip paintings. I think those paintings are some of the most beautiful paintings I've ever seen. Like, mm-hmm. and the idea of them are just beautiful, and everything about them is art for me, you know? And I know a lot of people disagree with that, don't like those paintings, even after the whole explanation of why they're important to art and blah, blah, blah. But the paintings that he did just before are, you know, they're more grid-like, and they have some imagery. They have like a 1940s feel to them, 30s. There's like post-cubism. There's Picasso elements in there. But you can really see where like Basquiat even took some of those early Pollocks and was inspired by them. Mm. Aside from just the imagery, I think what's really beautiful about those paintings for me is that knowing that he was on the way to the drip paintings. Mm. You know, it's like that idea is infused into the art for me. And I'm really into that kind of story almost in the work, just like the same way you would see the rise and fall of someone in a movie or a story. Like the fun part about the story is not necessarily knowing what happens at the end. It's the ride, you know? I feel like that those paintings for me is almost like a representation of that, you know?
Wow. Yeah, that's wonderful. Yeah. I can definitely see that sort of love and desire for being present, being in the moment, but also, you know, wanting that forward progression, and then also seeing that in someone's work that you admire. I'm actually not familiar with his earlier works, but I'll have to go and take a look at that. And
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, go ahead.
No, I was just saying that even before those abstract paintings too, he was, you know, he had figurative stuff too, when he was from his teacher, you know, he had like, there's some, I'm not too familiar, but I know there's like a self-portrait you can find from him.
Cool.
And, some other landscapes and stuff. That's not necessarily the earlier works I'm referring to. It's more just like right before these like abstract paintings. Mm. I think it was the time, maybe right when he met Lee Krasner, around that time, his partner. It's cool to see that stuff for me right now, because I think also, I feel like we are so saturated right now with, not we, but maybe me and a big part of the culture is so saturated right now with seeing art on Instagram and social media and just online in general, and in galleries too, even. I think it's all affected by social media, but a lot of imagery, you know, everything is so designed. And not saying my work isn't designed. I mean, my work is probably right up there too, in terms of like feeling very aware of itself and conscious. But as a fan looking the stuff that I'm looking at, I feel like I'm a little tired of just seeing the same, you know, kind of thing over and over. And I want something like those paintings to me feel very fresh, the early Pollocks, because it feels like, yeah. you know, it's before social media, before anyone's even seeing them on a daily basis or whatever, you know, unless you knew him and you went to his studio, you could see those paintings.
Yeah. Well, I can definitely see that in the progression of your work over time, is seeing that sort of like acceptance within yourself and transitioning into something that seems more personal. And yeah, I can understand, based off of what you said about Jackson Pollock and observing his career, like how that would be imbued a bit into the way that you think about your paintings and your progression. Yeah.
Also, one thing that I know, I keep referring to these like painters that are more like painterly, but last year and the year before, man, now with COVID too, it feels like I can't even remember which year it was, but wow, was it last year? Dang, no, it must have been 2 years ago now. I had a show with my friend Tamsin, who you met.
Yeah.
We did a collaborative show, the two of us. Mm-hmm. And so I'm like a Sunday abstract painter. So I have been exploring these other more painterly, you know, those paintings are more along the lines of like the de Kooning school. Not saying our paintings look like de Kooning, but like de Kooning is who comes up when we're painting all the time, you know, like, mm-hmm. well, wow, that was kind of a little de Kooning brush mark there or whatever. So those paintings are very along those lines. So I'm kind of getting already that outlet out in that collaboration. We're painting very abstractly. We're limiting our palette sometimes. We're painting large brushes. We're flipping the canvas over. We're painting wet on wet. We're using palette knife. It's a very like hands-on abstract expressionist approach. We're not painting super fast, we're painting slow. And I think that might be a next addition to our progress or step in our journey, is maybe picking up the pace a little bit, or maybe painting larger, painting a little messier. But so even though maybe that those elements aren't necessarily that literal in the works, that they have affected my and inspired my own works a little bit by getting some of those little messier moments, painting on top of it, allowing for some areas to be a little bit brushier. You know, in retrospect, these could be a proto to, you know, to that next evolution, like allowing the paintings to be a little bit more broken up and more thinking about the surface rather than just the narrative or one thing or the other. You know, it's going to have trying to get everything in there, right?
Yeah, definitely.
But yeah, those paintings that I'm painting with Tamsin, they're really, really fun.
I'd love to see them.
I'd love to see them. Yeah, I'll send you images of some. And we had a show actually in 2019 in November. We had our first show. We had 15 paintings collaborative. And
I don't think I've seen those.
Yeah, I'll send you some images. But cool. Not to jump too deep into that, but yeah, we had the process for that is we paint together the same time. So it's not like an old school collaboration where like I'll paint something, then like send it to her and she'll paint on it and then give it back. We actually meet up and are painting at the exact same time. And we start with an idea. Okay, we're only going to paint with black and white today. And we have a large canvas or whatever. And we do what we call the painter's alphabet, which I've learned was the drawing alphabet. We just took it to painting, and we have six stages, and then we loop around. So, and we alternate. So the six characters we use. So we're essentially creating a new identity as one. I mean, two of us, but almost like creating it as if one person was painting it. So we have a vertical line, a horizontal line, diagonal going the other direction, right? And then a C curve and an S curve. So those are six. So if I start, I'm going to paint verticals, right? And sometimes we limit, you can only make six marks. So I'll do six verticals and then she'll mix her paint. And then she'll do six horizontals and then I'll mix my paint and I'll do six diagonals. And then it doesn't mean you have to be so, you can be creative with your diagonals. Like your diagonals can be really tiny. They can be massive. You can have one huge diagonal going across the whole thing. Yeah. So each painting is a little different. And then we just alternate.
It's like you're having a conversation within the painting.
Exactly. And we've been calling it alphabet soup lately, you know, because it just becomes this big muddy like soup of all the alphabet letters, you know, or the characters in our little alphabet. Hmm. And sometimes the paintings are hideous, you know, like, and then sometimes they're so beautiful. And this is going back to the reason I brought it up is because of that Jackson Pollock thing. You know, I feel like we're onto something, and looking back at some of the paintings that I thought were hideous when we created them are some of my favorites now. And because we've created it, no one else created it. They're not meant to be beautiful images. From the start, we always have to remind ourselves that we're not trying to make a beautiful painting. We're just painting, you know, like we're seeing what comes out of it. And the result is actually a lot more beautiful when we are not being so aware of what it is exactly that we're doing. Like, yes, we have limitations and we do stop and think and talk about what it is that we're doing. But in order to create something new, it's not always going to be the most beautiful thing, right? Because when you're trying to create something beautiful, there's already rules there, right? You're using old rules and concepts of beauty. And when you're trying to create something new, beautiful, like what is that? You need time. It's like making a beautiful or an ugly baby. Like it's going to be an ugly baby until it's your baby. And you're like, oh yeah, I guess I like its big ears or whatever. You know what I mean?
Yeah. No, I understand. I understand the metaphor.
And so that to me is why some of the ones that I'm like, oh man, this painting is so bad, you know? And a month later, I'm like, oh, I want that painting. It's our painting, you know?
Interesting. All right. I definitely have to see these paintings. Yeah. Because I think you do have a good point. You have a good point there. if you already go in with the intention of, I don't know, like painting a still life, for instance, then you have all of these technical barriers, you know, that you've essentially trained yourself to be able to paint a cup a certain way or what have you, right? But if you go in there with the intention of just exploring and you have to remind yourself, it's kind of like a kid, you know, pushing paint around, right? Like generally they're not really aware of exactly what they're trying to do,
right?
But, or even like what colors go with what or anything like that. But there's also a certain amount of innate freedom that comes behind the idea of that, like a kid playing, right? And there's something
absolutely
about that. Yeah.
Yeah. And again, it's not for everyone, you know, like they're not necessarily meant to be for everyone, right? It's our exploration. Like, yes, we are asking for it by putting them up on a wall or trying to sell them or whatever, but that's not the point, you know. Just like the same way, you know, you would walk into someone's house and you see their kids paint on the wall, painting on the wall. And
yeah,
it, to them, it's unbelievable, right? And to you, like, unless you stared at it after a while, I'm like, oh yeah, I guess there is, like, you look for it, you know, but it takes a certain kind of person to find the beauty in the concept and not necessarily the result, which I think is a huge part of art, you know.
Or in the process as well, finding the beauty in the process.
Oh, as a creator.
Oh, as a creator or as
or the viewer.
As the viewer, yeah. I mean, sometimes yeah. people can just find beauty. I mean, you know, you talking about that, like I can see the beauty in the process of the creation and the collaboration, the conversation, you know. And
right.
I don't necessarily even need... Like that is inspiring to me, and I don't even necessarily need to see the result of what that was, because I think just the process of being open and being able to collaborate with someone in that way and not really even care about the result, I think there's something right. to be said about that, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, it's yeah. And then going back to what you were saying too, the other analogy, like the old cliche analogy is the road, right? I mean, it's like, if you're going to go hiking and you're already on this clear path that's been, you know, blazed or whatever versus the bushwhacker, right? Like the bushwhacking direction, you're going to get dirty. You're going to get ticks. You're going to get, you're going to step on poop, whatever, you know, and, it might take way longer. You might not have water along the way or whatever, you know, but you know, and you might die. But like you'll make it.
Yeah.
Once you make it, it's like, wow, like that was a crazy yeah. ride to get there, you know? And
yeah.
and again, it's not for everyone, you know?
Yeah.
And again, people are going to be like, dude, just take the road. Like, what are you doing? You know? And I feel like a lot of the times when we show people those paintings, they don't see it immediately. So I have to explain it, you know, and which is fine. I don't mind it. Like, I love those paintings. And the reason I actually talk more highly about those paintings than I do my own, because I'm not trying to like, just obviously there's moments when I talk about my work, but I'm talking about the process and what I like about them and whatever. But those paintings, since I painted them with someone else, I feel the confidence to say how much I love them and like how stoked I am on them. And versus like my own stuff, I'm like, well, it's my, yeah, if, you know, I kind of get a little more shy yeah. about it. But with those paintings, you know, I get, when we first had the show, you know, it was definitely like, it was the first time seeing a lot of people look, my friends looking at those paintings, and it definitely got a lot of looks of like, dude, why didn't you guys just take the road? You know, like what, like you could have made, these are so close to being like beautiful paintings, you know?
Yeah.
But we were so focused and keeping the integrity of the process. Like that's not our goal for this. You know, we both paint on the side. She's a painter. I'm a painter. We have our own thing. Like this was a very honest project that we love doing. And, you know, and it's not just about the painting, you know, we have great conversation while we're painting, and they're exhausting sessions because we're painting for 6 hours, or less or more sometimes, whatever. And it's just go, go, go. We don't really have a break. You know, as soon as I'm done with my 6 marks, she's up for her 6 marks. You know what I mean? It's just back and forth, back and forth. And, we are pretty respectful with each other. We never tell each other what to paint. Maybe occasionally we'll kind of be like, yeah, I don't know if pink's the right choice right now. You know, like
yeah,
something like that. But we're very like, And it hurts sometimes. You make a mark that you're like, dude, that's the mark. And then she'll go over and paint right over it. And, you know, so you just hold your tongue a little bit and you're like, all right, well, let's see where this goes. Right. Hmm. You're just letting that person trailblaze, right? Going back to that analogy. Yeah. It's like, definitely. if you were trailblazing with another person, I'm sure people on hikes get mad at each other all the time. You're going the wrong way. Mm-hmm. And it's like, no, we don't know where we're going. Right. You thought we were going to that mountain. I'm going to that mountain over there, you know?
yeah.
That's sort of like our paintings in a nutshell without the arguing, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think there's a beautiful metaphor within that. Definitely.
Yeah, and we just started painting. So we took a big break during COVID, and we just started painting again. And I think we have like four to six paintings underway right now. And the beautiful part about those paintings is that we never know when they're complete. We never know.
Yeah.
Like we decide when they're complete or not. But
yeah. Well, I guess you know, I don't want to take too much of your time up, man. But I'll ask one more question. And
yeah, for sure.
I definitely asked you this question before, but do you have any advice for artists and creatives?
Oh man, I feel, I always love seeing young painters and especially as a teacher, you know, I always see students and they're, you know, 18 to 22 just getting started. And I love the genuine process, I guess, or when people are really genuine just about creating, you know, so not forcing it, one, right? But two, just finding what it is that you want to spend time on. And, you know, again, the reward system, it's not, don't think about the reward of like what you're going to get from completing the piece, but really try to be honest about what it is that you want to be spending your time doing, because that's the most important thing, right? So I think, you know, explore as much as you can and experiment as much as you can, but, you know, just try to find what your quote unquote, like, dances in the creative the field, yeah. Right? What is it that you want to spend your time doing, workshopping in the studio? Because that's what you're going to be doing. And I just had a conversation with a friend a couple of weeks ago, Dugan, and he was visiting, I think he lives in New York right now, but he's a painter, artist. But he was talking to me about that too. It's like he wants to be a painter and learned how to paint because I think early on that's what he thought he wanted to do, but he actually doesn't really enjoy the act of painting that much. You know, he'd rather be like creating something more like sculpturally or hands-on or something like that. Yeah. So you can still be creative and experiment. It doesn't mean it has to be painting, right? Or drawing or whatever. It could be photography or dance or installation art or whatever. But you are, I think for it to be a lifelong thing, I feel like really enjoying the actual process and the investigation of the journey, right? The bushwhacking or whatever analogy you want to use, like that's what you got to find the motivation and medium, right?
Yeah.
That suits you.
I agree. Yeah. No, I mean, I think what you said is really powerful. Understanding what you want to spend your time on. You know, I think
Right. There's
probably a lot of people that take the more tried and true road in life, and maybe they'll reap some of the rewards of that. You know, if we're talking about in the more practical, pragmatic sense, monetary rewards, you know, maybe they get a 9-to-5 job or something like that. And that's fine too. You know, if that's, you know, what you want to do with your time. But I think it's really about understanding what you want to do with your time, whether that's painting or whether that is some other creative pursuit. But to be really honest with that, I mean, at the end of the day, if you can look at yourself in the mirror and be proud of the person that you see in the mirror. Yeah. I mean, I think that's partially, you know,
there's one last thing too, sure. I've probably brought this up before, but Joseph Campbell, right? The hero's journey.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's someone that wrote about it afterwards, and I'm pretty sure it's actually in the Joseph Campbell writings, but about following your bliss, right? And discovering it or looking for it. You know, he was saying poets and writers and artists spend most of their time living in their creative space, in their bliss. And that's a huge part that is taken away from normal society or working society, because you have four things. Maybe I'm not sure if the number is right, but let's just for the sake of the conversation right now and for the argument or whatever, the point is you have four things that you need, right? So like shelter, right? So like a shelter over your head, food, love, and bliss. There might be one other thing in there, whatever, but let's say those four things add to like a healthy life, happy life. Exactly. You take one of those things away, food and, or love or shelter, and you're struggling, right? Your survival, is in jeopardy. Your happiness, you're depressed, whatever. And a lot of people don't really have that bliss card in there, right? Because that bliss that they should be kind of fulfilling, they're spending it at their 9 to 5, you know, working. Some people have that and find it at work. You know, they're creative and they're fulfilled at work, whatever it is that they're doing, a designer, architect, or whatever it is, you could definitely find it. Not saying it's not going to be work, but you can definitely be happy and fulfilled there, right? But there are a lot of people that hate their jobs, right? So trying to find that balance there with, you know, being able to support all these because of that job is tricky, you know? So I definitely feel blessed to have been able to, you know, the last 10 years teach art, and that's where I'm able to, like, you know, food and shelter, finding that and discovering that and really being honest about what makes you happy in that sense is also really crucial, I think.
Yeah. I agree. Well, Emilio, thanks. Yeah. Thanks for coming on and doing this, man. Yeah.
Dude, thank you, man. Always a great conversation with you. And dude, like every time, man, we can go on for hours and hours and hours. I feel like we're just getting warmed up, but until next time for sure.
Yeah. We'll definitely have you on again. Hopefully it won't be, you were one of the first like 30, I think.
Oh, wow. That's awesome. I have to go back and listen to that, man. I'm probably saying it's probably like a repeat interview right now. I'm probably saying a lot of the things from back then, but
I don't know, man. I mean, it would probably be, I'm sure there's probably overlaps, but you know, you and I are both like completely different people from then and now, and you know,
for sure. But cool. All right, brother.
All right, man. All right, take it easy, man.
Thank you, dude. All right, man. See ya.
Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, aka Justin Dosher Hopkins. Creative producer is Noah Wainwright. YouTube and creative support is by Tyler Scully. Thanks so much for tuning in. See you next time.